Hello and welcome to the Widow's Oil. Today I want to read an article from a website called God's Kingdom Ministries. And on this website, there is a book written. There are many books written by, I assume it's the author of the website, whom I don't know. And I don't know all his work, but there is this one book called The Struggle for the Birthright. And I'd like to read us one chapter from this book, which is very good and very much explains me one of the things that I've been trying to get across in my channel, namely the who is this Israel according to the Bible. And this writer really did a good job, I think, of explaining this. So let us have a look at that. So this book is called The Struggle for the Birthright. You can look it up yourself if you want to read there from God's Kingdom Ministries. I will put the link in the description box below. And you can read the book for free online. So if we go to chapter 7, the conflict, let us read it there. I am going to read the chapter for you, but I may not include everything in the video, depending on how important I find it. But of course, you are most welcome to go and read this yourself. Chapter 7, The Conflict. So this book is about the conflict that we see at the moment and the matter of Zionism and the matter of who truly is Israel. We have a situation where if we speak the truth, we are called a name, and we are actually treated very badly, where, in fact, the Bible is very clear that the matter is spiritual if we follow the New Testament. But if we fall back into the law and we are blinded, it is very easy to then believe wrong things and then to actually call Christians heretics and haters when they only speak the truth. And so I want to read this chapter because this writer of this book has done an excellent job to explain how Jesus actually came and fulfilled prophecy and how the church came about. So I'm going to start with the second paragraph here. It says, classic replacement theology as taught traditionally in the Roman Catholic Church and some Protestant denominations is not biblically accurate. But neither is the view of their main opponents who advocate Messianic Judaism. We will show in this chapter that the good figs of Judah, namely those Judahites who followed Jesus, form the trunk of the tree of the New Testament Christianity. This fig tree producing good fruits following the King of Judah retained the right to be called by the tribal name of Judah. They are the true Jews, as it were. We saw in chapter 5 that God saw the nation of Judah as a fig tree in Jeremiah 24. We saw also that the nation was actually divided into two groups of people, those whose fruit were very good and those whose fruit were very bad. This is really no different from any other nation, for there is not a nation in the world that has all righteous people or all unrighteous people. But in the case of Judah, it is a matter of divine separation into two distinct fig trees, because God intended to treat them differently. He intended to give Judah's dominion mandate to those who produced good fruit, and at the same time he intended to disinherit those who produced bad fruit. Jesus himself produced good fruit. He was born of a Judahite mother as proven in the genealogies of Matthew 1 and Luke 3. But as the king of Judah, he was more than just a fig branch that was producing good fruit. He was the tree itself. He was the trunk of the tree, to which were attached various branches that bore good fruit. Jesus said as much when he used a different motif of the vine and the branches. And that's what I've been saying in my earlier videos, is that it is wrong to speak of Hebrew roots, because Jesus himself says himself he is the root. John 15 verse 1 to 6 says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit he takes away, and every branch that bears fruit he prunes it, that it may bear more fruit. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up, and they gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. It is clear from this that only those who abide in Christ will bear the type of fruit that God is seeking. If one claims to be in Christ, but does not produce these fruits of the kingdom, he is cut off. And if anyone does not abide in me, Jesus said, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up. Surely he had in mind those Judahites who had rejected him as the Messiah. Only a few days earlier, Jesus had cursed the fig tree, and the disciples had marveled that it had dried up by the following morning. He was saying then that the people who produced no fruit, or as Jeremiah put it, those who produced only bad figs that could not be eaten, would be cut off. This is precisely what happened. Judah split into two factions, into two trees. Those who accepted Jesus as Messiah became the branches of the good fig tree. These were the inheritors of the dominion mandate given to Judah. Of these, Jesus said he would prune them in order that they would bring forth even more fruit. Those who refused to accept Jesus as Messiah were cut off and are no longer inheritors of the dominion mandate. Jesus clearly said that there is no way that anyone can bear fruit apart from being attached to Christ. Replacement theology. A Gentile church did not replace a Jewish church. The bad figs were simply cut off, and the good figs of Judah, who followed Jesus, the king of Judah, were left to carry the banner of the Judah church. There was no replacement here, as classic Roman Catholic theology has taught in the past. The Catholic Church seems to have proclaimed that they were the total replacement. And it seems from there that the trouble comes with calling things replacement theology, when you say the church is a continuation of the church in the wilderness, which Stephen spoke of in Revelation 7. So it seems this problem comes from the theology of the Roman Catholic Church. Okay, so let's just continue. The promises to Abram were never transferred from one people to another. The promises simply continued through the unbroken line of the good fig tree of Judah. Replacement theology teaches that the fig tree was rooted out and replaced by an apple tree. Now, I've never said that. If you listen to my previous videos, which I did at the beginning, I've always said that the church was that original continuation. So it seems there are different ways that they describe replacement theology, and that's why they use that term to attack even those that speak the truth. And that's why I always say we must be so careful of labels, because they start to be used as a slogan word, and then they people are just totally put off if you say somebody teaches replacement theology or someone is an anti-Semite, then they don't even listen what he said further. So that's why I've always said we must be very careful of these labels, you know. We do great damage of them. For example, people use the word Calvinist as sort of a derogatory term. But I've learned that if you listen to the theology of different denominations, you can learn from each one. They all have a different focus on the truth, and they may have errors in them, but they have things that are true. And so if one sort of is unwilling to listen to the viewpoints of others, you don't pick up on all these nuggets to understand things. And if you hold fast to some theology, let's say you're a Calvinist and you will not listen to anybody else, then again, you never grow. You just remain with the knowledge you have, and then mixed up with the doctrines of men that are also part and parcel of a system like that. And so I am very careful of such, you know, labels, and of closing my ears to hearing different viewpoints. So let us continue. The promises to Abram were never transferred from one people to another. The promises simply continued through the unbroken line of the good fig tree of Judah. Replacement theology teaches that the fig tree was rooted out and replaced by an apple tree. This did not happen. The truth is that there were two fig trees, one good and one bad. Now, of course, this is, I think it's in the book of Jeremiah. It's in one of the prophets where the Lord speaks of the good fig tree and the bad fig tree, which had figs too bad to eat. And he said to the good figs that they needed to go under the king of Babylon. So that's where the fig tree symbolism comes from. Okay, both were of Judah. The bad fig tree was rooted out, and the good fig tree remained to carry on the kingdom of God upon earth. The good fig tree did not replace anything because it was always there. So you see that the church is just a continuation of what God did. That's why Stephen in Acts 7 speaks of the church in the wilderness. Likewise, it is not a Jewish church, at least not in the way that people mean when they make that claim. It is certainly a Judahite fig tree, but those who make the claim that this is a Jewish church usually say also that Christian believers are supposed to reunite with Jews who are still cut off from Christ. In other words, they are attempting to reunite the good fig tree with a bad fig tree. Nearly always, this movement teaches that the bad fig tree is still God's chosen nation. And that's exactly what we see in this Zionism. And they are rabid about this. And who is more rabid is the Christian Zionists that are actually turning against their own fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And I've experienced this myself. That they will not even speak to you. They cut you off as if you are of the devil. But Jesus said that if they call him Beelzebub, what would they do to those who follow him? The problem with this view is that it is a move to engraft the branches of the good fig trees to the bad fig tree, rather than the other way around. That teaching would ultimately bring all Christians into Judaism rather than bringing Jews to Christ. Exactly. That's exactly what I see where this is going. The fact is, the bad fig tree will never bring forth fruit,
For that was the nature of Jesus' curse. Remember in Matthew 21, he said in Matthew 21, verse 19, seeing a lone fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it except leaves only. And he said to it, no longer shall there ever be any fruit from you. And at once the fig tree was withered. And that was Jesus's prophecy of that he would end that system, which then came to its final conclusions, which then came to its final conclusion in 70 AD, when that when Jerusalem was totally destroyed and the temple burnt. The only solution is for the individual branches to be cut off from that dead fig tree and grafted to the only tree that can give them life, Jesus Christ, the trunk of the good fig tree. As long as conversion to Christ is repugnant to a Jew, he is not a partaker of the dominion mandate of Judah, nor is he of that tribe in the sight of God, as we will prove shortly from Scripture. The good fig tree was the church, it says there in the title. The good fig tree attempted to remain in the old land for a time, but conflict soon forced most of them to flee for their lives into other parts of the Roman Empire. The book Acts tells the story of this persecution. Even so, the fig tree grew rapidly. There were 3,000 converted on the day of Pentecost. Each time other Judahites were converted, the good fig tree grew in strength. The disciples had great success, even though they did not hesitate to place responsibility for the crucifixion of Jesus upon their own nation. The apostles did not believe that they ought to tread softly on this controversial issue. They preached boldly, and multitudes repented and followed Jesus Christ. These multitudes of Judahites were natural branches of the fig tree, yet they were cut off from the kingdom tree, whose trunk was Jesus Christ, until they repented and placed their faith in Jesus as the Messiah. The good fig tree continued to grow, and soon the opposition in the temple became so alarmed that they began to seriously persecute the church. Yes, the good fig tree was the church. It was the inheritor of the dominion mandate given to Judah. It was not a Gentile church, as is often taught. It was a Judah church and will always be a Judah church. And as I always say, people, avoid using this word Gentile, because it's only going to become a new word to persecute us, like the word racist and like the word anti-Semite and all the different words that are used and become slur words, which then shut people up not to speak the truth. So don't use that word, the word Gentile, unless you're explaining this matter and speaking of this problem. The good figs from the Judah tree were soon scattered by persecution into all parts of the Roman Empire and beyond it. Wherever they went, they told the good news to those who would listen. They fed all nations with the good fruit from the tree and made many converts among non-Judahites. As these new converts came to Christ, they were then grafted as branches into that fig tree of Judah. Within a century, the church or fig tree began to bear many different types of fruit from all nations, with each branch obtaining its life from Jesus Christ. In fact, soon the figs were outnumbered by the apples, pears, and apricots from the engrafted branches of other nations. Okay, so he's not, you know, he's just making his own symbolism here. But this is how I understand it, that Jesus first came and preached to that remnant in Judah, and then he added the lost sheep. They went out and the lost sheep was scattered in all the known world. So they first went out then to them, And then from there, the pagans were also grafted in. So there was a plan and a pattern, you know, like we read, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all of the world. But it's often obscured by the Bible translations when they use the word Gentiles. So we generally think that those Gentiles were only pagans, when many of them were basically the Jew by genealogy remnant scatterlings in the Gentile so-called nations. But in spite of the great variety of branches and fruit that the tree was bearing, it was still a Judah tree in its trunk. It never was a Gentile church, nor did a Gentile church replace Judah. Judah simply divided into good and bad trees, with the good tree of Judah becoming the heir of the dominion mandate, and then this good Judah tree was opened up to receive branches from all other trees of the world. So later on, if a tribe somewhere comes to Christ and over time that becomes a Christian nation, it then becomes a branch. So that's why Jesus spoke of that mustard seed, which would become this massive tree that covers the whole earth. And when that nation becomes Christian, it's not expected of that nation to become Jewish. They retain their nationhood, but they become a Christian nation. So it's not even true that the Jews need to let go of their customs. But you see, the problem is Jew is a religion. It's a religion, and it's a ethnos, a ethnic identity. So it's very, very confusing. All of it's very confusing. And what they need to let go is their Judaism. They don't have to let go of being Jewish. God did not plant a new tree and call it the Gentile church. Instead, God took his fig tree and engrafted branches of apples, pears, apricots, and so on. Those new branches, though part of the fig tree, continue to bear other fruits. Well, my understanding is if you graft something into a fig tree, it will bear figs. So I think he's just using this as a way to explain that the people are different, the different ethnicities are different. But of course, the way I understand it, every branch will bear the same pattern as the fig tree, which is the im it will bring forth the image of Jesus Christ in the people. When people of other races are engrafted into this fig tree, they do not change their race or their genetics. And then he says they simply produce different types of fruit. Well, of course, that nation is going to bring forth their own variety of Christianity. And Jesus did say, "In my Father's house are many mansions." God does love variety. It says, and in the end, the tree will bear 12 kinds of fruits. I think that 12 is just a symbolic number, like the 12 tribes or the 12 apostles. So it just refers to a fullness, maybe. As we read in Revelation 22, verse 2, which says, and on either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruits, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. For if you have a nation that becomes Christian, then there is healing in that nation, because Jesus is a healer. The tree of life is Jesus Christ, and it is made up of many branches, those who are in Christ or part of his body. Those who rejected Jesus were collectively the corrupt fig tree that could only produce figs that were so bad that they could not be eaten. That corrupt fig tree lost its legal status as the tribe of Judah when they rejected the Messiah and usurped his throne, Even as Absalom usurped the throne of his father David, even so for the past 2,000 years, a steady stream of Jews have repented and followed Jesus Christ. These have been grafted back into the good fig tree, and with the other believers are joint heirs with Christ in the dominion mandate. It is not the case, however, that Christian Jews have some special status towards God which allows them to rule above any others. Figs are not better than apples, they just have a different flavor. Neither are apples better than figs, they just have a different flavor. But in order to understand this, we must look at the divine law to see what actually happened. So now I'm going to skip some of the article, which of course you can go and read yourself, as I will put the link in the description box. And I'm going to continue here, where it says, who is a Jew? Which is also a very, very important aspect where the Bible itself defines who is a Jew. The church and Judah are the same entity. The church is the called out body of people called out of the bad fig tree of Judaism to be grafted into the good fig tree of Jesus Christ. Although there are non-Judahites who have been grafted into this Judah church, the church itself is the legitimate tribe of Judah. One will get into big trouble if you say that. But you, reader and listener of this, you need to let the Holy Spirit show you the truth. So in Romans 8, verse 28 to 29, there is a magnificent definition of a Jew. But if people do not have the Holy Spirit, it's very difficult for them to even see what this is saying. It says, for he is not a Jew, who is one outwardly. Neither is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew who is one inwardly. And circumcision is that which is of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the letter. And his praise is not from men, but of God. Yeah, is Paul's definition of a Jew. Well, it's actually the Holy Spirit's definition of a Jew, because the Holy Spirit inspired Paul there. And it defines it both negatively and positively. He tells us that there are two groups of people, each laying claim to being a Jew. Remember, Jesus also spoke in Revelation of those who say they are Jews, but are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. The bad figs are the apparent Jews, for they are recognized by men as Jews. The good fig trees were the real Jews, though their identity was hidden or not so well known to the general public. The apparent Jews were those who followed the Judaism of the day. The hidden Jews were those whose hearts were right with God. The apparent Jews laid claim to their tribal status and covenant status with God by means of physical circumcision. The hidden Jews laid claim to their tribal status and covenant status with God by means of the heart circumcision. And that is why I don't quite agree with the author regarding the where he says it brings forth apples and things like that. I'd like to keep to the fig, because you see, when we really are in Christ, eventually even our national or ethnic affiliation starts to be less to us than our identification of being of the New Jerusalem and being the true Jew of the heart. You see, and that is why Jesus can connect all different ethnicities effortlessly. And it is so beautiful because everybody is grafted into the same root, and so they bring forth the same figs. They may initially still have different fruit, but if a nation or a person remains and matures, they will become more and more like Christ. In other words, just because unbelieving Jews were able to retain the name of Judah, usually in its shortened form Jew, This did not mean that they were really Jews at all, confirmed by Jesus in Revelation. From the perspective of the Christians, including Paul, the unbelieving Jews had been cut off from their people and no longer had the right before God to call themselves Jews. Only those Judahites who accepted the mediator of the new covenant, the King of Judah, the custodian of the tribal name, could lawfully claim to be Judahites. So you can see here also this confusion with the word Jew. But it's best to use the Bible, even using these terms that are used nowadays. The Bible, being the sword of the Spirit, is still able to make the truth shine forth. We don't have to be defining terms and things like that, because if we want to give people an answer of our faith, most people are not scholars and are interested in all the terms. So we must be able to use scripture itself, even with words translated that should be translated Judahites, translated as Jews. We should be able to use the scripture to still bring forth the truth. And we can. It is strange that in the past few decades, Messianic Judaism has promoted this idea that the true Jews, followers of Jesus, King of Judah, ought to be grafted to the dead fig tree that God cut off nearly 2,000 years ago for its lawlessness. The basic error of Messianic Judaism is that they want to replace the good fig trees with bad figs. This is their brand of replacement theology. Yet they call people, Christians who speak the truth, call us replacement theologists. They call true Christians replacement theologists. They call the bad figs God's chosen people, and then attempt to identify with their religious practices as a ploy to induce some of them to accept Christ. You see, I won't be surprised if the whole Messianic Judaism comes from Christians who thought that they could get Jews to turn to Christ easier by following that way. And that is going to turn badly on us. Just like in the time of the Maccabeans, they forced Edomites to become Jews. And in the end, that was also to the detriment of them around the first century. So using trickery and or making things easier never works out good. See, this is now bad for us. It is bad for the Christian church. But I do know that even things that are meant for evil, or where we err, God will eventually turn that for good for us also. So we do not rail about the things that happened or point the finger, but it is just so typical of us, of mankind, to try and force things. Just like Abram and Sarah had Ishmael and it worked out badly for them. In the same way, the Judahites, round about Jesus' time, force converted the Edomites, the descendants of Esau, and then they ruled over them like Herod, and they were not good to them. And now in our day, I see this Messianic Judaism. It really would not surprise me if it comes from Christianity, who so badly wanted the Jewish people to turn to Jesus, and maybe created this in the hope that it would make it easier for them. And now this is going to turn to bite. This is like drinking with drunkards in order to induce them to stop drinking. The apostles would have rolled over in their graves. Never did they attempt to get Christians to return to the old brand of Judaism. In fact, the Apostle Paul wrote entire Gospels refuting such an idea. There is no life in the religion of Judaism, for it has rejected and continues to reject the only one in whom is life. One cannot force it to become Christianized by converting to Judaism. To try to bring Judaism back to life by swarming its ranks with Christians is a fallacy of the first order. It was when Jesus died, and they sought his body in the grave. The angel said, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" Because Judaism, Jesus called it the dead, you see. And if we graft Christians onto that dead fig tree, we will get a second death, another dead religion. So I'm going to go on here to the early church. The temple leaders in Jerusalem began to persecute the Christian believers very soon after they crucified Jesus. Okay. And then it tells there of the beginnings of the persecution early in Acts. So I'm going to just skip that part, which you can read yourself if you want to. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are on trial today for the benefit done to a sick man, as to show how this man has been made well, let it be known to all of you and all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name, this man stands here before you in good health. He is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the very cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved." Few people questioned Peter's words until recently. Then, in the name of having better relations with Judaism, various Christian leaders first began to blame the Romans for the crucifixion, denying the scriptures that the sacrifice had to be made by the Levitical priests alone in order to be acceptable to God. Then, more recently, various Christian leaders began to think that Jews are actually saved apart from faith in Jesus Christ. I, myself, the author of this book, first saw this view written in Billy Graham's My Answer column in the 1960s, although I doubt that this was written by Mr. Graham himself. It was too far out of character for him to have written it personally. The article said that the Gentiles are saved by grace through faith in Christ, while Jews are saved by the law. That is ecumenism, where they want to bring all the faiths together also by saying each one has their own path, denying the fact that Jesus said he is the only way to the Father. But if that were the case, then no Jew can or could ever be saved, for there is none righteous, no, not one. Not a single Jew has ever been perfect before the law in his entire life, unless perhaps he died very early in life. Now, I don't know if I agree with that second part that he says even there, but I'm not going to belabor the point here. I would just say there is no one perfect through the law. I myself would never make salvation for a Jew to be such a hopeless cause. At any rate, when we read the book of Acts, we find Jews everywhere being saved by faith in Jesus Christ. I would like to ask those so-called Bible teachers to tell me the date that this requirement for salvation changed. But you see, it happened because of politically correctness and ecumenism and Zionism, and the great delusion that has come upon us. Okay, and then I've skipped some of it, some of the history. He says, yeah, this is the history of the early church. It was a church of good figs, not bad figs. The bad figs were jealous of the good figs and refused to believe that Jesus was the Messiah, even though great signs and miracles were done among them. Yet in the eyes of God, these believers carried the dominion mandate of Judah. Because remember, the prophecy to Judah was that there would be a lawgiver until he who to whom it belongs, Shiloh, comes, which is the Messiah. They were the true Jews, for they carried the tribal name of Judah and its calling. The good fig the good figs did not consider anyone Jew or otherwise to be in saving covenant with God apart from Jesus Christ. And the church till very recently, I can remember, and I'm only in my 50s, would never have considered the folly that is now being taught. They boldly preached repentance, telling the people that they had to repent of the rejection and crucifixion of the Messiah in order to be saved. That message has not changed, even if modern theologians say it has. The Bible is still the Word of God, even if the traditions of men contradict it. Yeah, and so I find this article really explains very well to me the matter of who is Israel. It doesn't, in the Bible, it doesn't really call us Judah. Jesus is called the Lion of the tribe of Judah, but the Lion is a lamb. His character is a lamb. And when we desire a bloody Messiah who wages war with a physical weapon, then we are desiring the Antichrist. The weapon of Jesus Christ that comes out of his mouth is the sword of the Spirit. And when men get destroyed by it, it is because they twist this, the word of God, to their own destruction.